Thank you. God, our weakness by your mercy, that we might celebrate the holy mysteries which have been given, for the renewal and redemption of our weak nature, through the mercy of your beloved Son, the Lord of all, forever.
Amen.
While the pleasant fragrance of your tender love graces us, our Lord and God, our souls are enlightened by the knowledge of your truth. May we be a worthy wealth of the revelation of your beloved Son from heaven. There we will praise you unceasingly, glorify you in your crown church, which is filled with all graces and blessings. For you are the Lord and Creator of all forever.
Amen. Then Manoah entreated the angel of the Lord,
Please, let us detain you and prepare a gift for you. And the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, if you detain me, I will not eat of your food. But if you make ready a burnt offering, then offer it to the Lord. For Manoah did not know that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, what is your name? So that when your words come true, we may honor you. And the angel of the Lord said to him, why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful? So Manoah took the kid with the cereal offering and offered it upon the rock of the Lord. To him were his wonders. And when the flame went up toward heaven from the altar, the angel of the Lord ascended in the flame of the altar while Manoah and his wife looked on, and they fell on their faces to the ground. The angel of the Lord appeared no more to Manoah and to his wife. Then Manoah knew that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to his wife, we shall surely die, for we have seen God. But his wife said to him, if the Lord had meant to kill us, he would not have accepted a burnt offering and a cereal offering in our hands, or shown us all these things, or now announced to us such things as these. And the woman bore a son, and called him Samson. And the boy grew, and the Lord blessed him.
Lighten our thoughts, our Lord and God, that we might be attentive to understand and savor the sweetness of your life-giving and divine commands. Grant that through your grace and mercy, that we'll benefit from them, the gifts of love, hope, and salvation for the body and soul, and always sing the perpetual praise to you at all times, Lord of all, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, forever.
Our reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to the holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, how the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promises in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for all the ages in God who created all things, that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be known to the principalities and the powers in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose which he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have the boldness and confidence of access through our faith in him. Let us stand in preparation to hear the Holy Gospel.
نزل على حنوث طالا وتصفي عنها πουθένα, βιώμα, μανιά, μου παρήνε, λιά, που πέρα πάρα λεσέν με μπάβε του Ζακράνη, ντζούμπλα, γυμνε ο μέρα παρέν, λα, ελε Ιωάννεν, άγιος πρία.
Now when the time came for Elizabeth to be delivered, and she gave birth to a son, and her neighbors and kinsfolk heard that the Lord had shown great mercy to her, they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they would have named him Zechariah after his father. But his mother said, "Not so. He shall be called John." And they said to her, "But none of your kindred or your family is called by this name." And they made signs to his father, inquiring what he would have been called. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote, "His name is John." And they all marveled, and immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue loosed, and he spoke, blessing God. And fear came on all their neighbors, and all these things were talked about through all the hill country of Judea. And all who heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, "What then will this child be?" For the hand of the Lord was with him. Bring them back to life, you know, who would it be if you were to have, like, child with them, you know? For me, like, top five, one of them would be Zechariah. Because I'm really curious as to how his months of silence, and a few weeks ago we talked about that, the silence, but how that led to his conversion. Even though he was a high priest, he was still in need of a conversion. And he was certain, however it was revealed to him, that his son's name was to be John. And so when he made that known through the writing of the tablet, the first thing he did when he spoke was to bless God, right? To give praise to God. Now, I want us particularly, though, this morning, to notice this line, very simple line. It says, "And her neighbors and kinsfolk heard that the Lord had shown great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her." So the neighbors, her friends, her family, they knew that there was something dramatic that was happening because, you know, her husband isn't talking and she was old. And so they saw how God is working in her life, and they were happy. And they wanted to participate in this joy, and so they showed up for the birth of John. And then they showed up again 8 days later, as it was custom for the circumcision. Now, the word John means God is gracious. The word John means God has been gracious, or God has shown his grace, or God has shown his mercy. And so what's happening is the people around Elizabeth and Zechariah have acknowledged, have seen how God has shown his grace to Zechariah and to Elizabeth. And because they realize what God has done for them, and they're happy, their neighbors wanted to participate in this celebration, not of simply a woman conceiving a child, but of how gracious God is. Now, what I want us to pray about is this, is how often do we rejoice in how gracious God is to those around us? More often than not, when we see someone on Instagram And they are in, I don't know, name a city that's not Sterling Heights, right? When we see someone who is in Mexico, right, on Instagram, and you're just got home from work, right? And you're exhausted and it's freezing cold. Typically, the first thing that comes in your mind is, man, I wish I was in Mexico. Saka lala. Ha, okay, thank you. No offense, please don't get offended. I know sometimes everyone gets offended really easily these days. No offense, I don't mean to offend you by telling you you get offended easily. How often do we look at this person who's celebrating, whether again it's on social media, whether you know them, they're your family members, whether they're your fellow classmates that maybe did better than you on an exam? When was the last time you got a C minus on your exam? And the person who thought they were gonna fail, oh my god, I did so bad, got an A minus. You wanted to punch him in the face. How often did you rejoice with them for doing better than you, whether it's reading or math? Huh? How often do we rejoice in God's graciousness to our neighbors? Because again, the temptation is, how come God isn't gracious to me? And I, as a priest, hear this all the time from people. You know, Father, no matter what I do, I fail. No matter what I do, no matter what I pray for, I don't get what I want. They don't necessarily say that in those words, but that's what it sounds like, and that's basically what they're saying. But everybody around me, this person, oh, and then here's the kicker. This person is the biggest sinner, and they have everything. God gives them everything. And we are laughing because we know it's true. Sometimes we're afraid to even say that out loud, but it's a thought in our heads. Now, when we don't see, and when we don't rejoice for God's graciousness to those around us, then we will 100% always be blind to God's graciousness to us. If we're only looking and if we're only rejoicing in God's graciousness to us, we're going to be miserable. Because we're going to constantly look at our neighbors and compare. And so, within that silence, that silent time, I remember when we were younger, my parents would punish us if I were to argue with my siblings. Might give you guys some ideas for punishment, parents. If I were to say something mean to one of my siblings, I'd have to bite my tongue. And I'd have to keep biting my tongue until the sibling who I offended releases me from my punishment. Okay? Good idea, huh? Sorry, guys. I'm really sorry about that. Or if I hit someone, and I've never hit any one of my siblings, I'd have to sit on my hands until the sibling that I hit allows me to release them. Okay, now, the point of it was what? In that silence, to think about what I said. When he was, it was revealed to him that he was going to have a son, right? Responded in a sense of doubt. And he was made silent. He was silenced until he thought about that doubt and could come to that conversion factor of how gracious God is. And then, throughout this period of time, and when he saw that those around him also acknowledged God's graciousness, he, through the naming of his son John, by naming him John, acknowledging in a particular sense how gracious God is, then, and only then, was able to speak and proclaim praise to God. So, by us acknowledging God's graciousness of our neighbor is going to also help them come to this recognition of God's graciousness in their life. And if we're doing this for each other, we're going to see how actively God is working in us and around us. So at this Mass, particularly I want us to take a moment to think about maybe a person in our life who we see God is gracious with, and maybe at some times we are on that verge of jealousy of, whether it's someone's, again, success or good relationship or good children. Sometimes parents say, oh my gosh, I can't believe their kids are so good. My kids are horrible. Right? To be able at this Mass not to thank God for what God has given to us, but I want us to offer this Mass as a Mass of thanksgiving for God showing His grace, His graciousness, to that individual in our life that we don't always thank God for blessing them.
Lord, have mercy. is the adored name of the glorious King, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who created the world and its inhabitants with grace and mercy, redeemed humanity through his love, provided the world for grace and the world to majesty. Countless heavenly beings and myriads of holy angels, kneeling to him, ministered by your Spirit, glorified your name, and holy charity and spiritual service. They offer praise to your Lordship as they praise and glorify without ceasing, and proclaim one of the country and its inhabitants, the city and those who dwell in, surround you, O Lord, with a strong wall, and you're really far from it by your grace only. And we also, O Lord, your humble need and wretched servants, who gathered in your name, who stand before you this morning, who receive your tradition, the example of your Son, while rejoicing, glorified, and exalted, we commemorate and perform this great review, holy life, you made by mystery. Passion, death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
In silence and in reverence, stand and pray that peace be with us.
body of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit forever.
Amen.
The sacred body is signed with the forgiving blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So our calendars are in and available. What's good about them is they have readings for every Sunday. That's really the one thing that's different than every other calendar. It's the only reason I would actually buy it, to be honest. But anyway, the theme is a new theme from based on the scriptures for this year, so you guys can check that out. We also have this cool little coloring book. We got it from the Chaldean Museum that they produced it. It's by A to Z in the Chaldean coloring book, so it goes through all of the Chaldean letters, which is kind of cool. I mean, really, if you're an adult, you can also, if you want to learn Chaldean, you can also use this. Again, no offense. Okay. We have our mass schedules for Christmas in the lobby. And then we have confessions at Our Lady of Perpetual Health for like last-minute confessions on Thursday, the 20th, at Our Lady of Perpetual Health from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. And then on Saturday, the 22nd, there'll be confessions at St. George at 6:30. Also on the way out, we have a giving tree where you can grab an ornament and bring the gift with you back next week, and we'll be distributing those to the homeless. And then a couple job opportunities that have opened up in our community. One, I mentioned last week, is the Chaldean Museum that's at Shenandoah, and the bulk part of that job right now is grant writing. So if you're a good writer, if you have a bachelor's degree, you can apply for that. There's also a job opening in our diocese. So you'd be working at the bishop's office in Southfield, and that is to oversee the safe environment, which is really the protecting God's children department, and also director of communications within the diocese, within the parishes, overseeing social media, etc. So if you want a more detailed job description about either one of those, you can call the parish office and ask for me, and I'll just forward it to you. I have an email. Okay, God bless you guys, and have a happy Sunday.